Good evening and welcome to Indian College of Anesthesiologists. Today, we are covering Indian College of Anesthesiologists. Or much talked about area where more clarification talked about area than in Ukraine.
More clarification
and area is in Ukraine. On oxygen
and area is on oxygen therapy.
It's a two-part session, and the first part will deal with the short lectures on production of medical oxygen and its cause to human body cell. And the next lecture will be conventional oxygen therapy and modified oxygen therapy in COVID times. And the second part is a critical evaluation, clarification discussion on oxygen therapy through a panel discussion. And with an advice, what is best possible course of management of oxygen in patients. The panelists today are seasoned, expertised, and well-knowledgeable anesthesiologists of India. They are Dr. Jaggi Vasudev Devatia, Dr. Anjan Trikka, Dr. Anup Kumar, and Dr. Anil Satyadas. I'm sure each one is known to you very well. Dr. J.V. Devatia is a senior academician and was the head of the department at Tata Medical Center, Mumbai. He's a well-known speaker, accepted professor and teacher, and has overwhelming critics. And Dr. Anjan Trikka, a senior professor and an erudite academician from All India Institute of Medical Sciences, known to you, and he said he has very, very enviable credits in anesthesia academics and is a man Friday for Government of India on medical legal matters, consumer protection, and standardization of equipments, as well as of academic clarifications. And Dr. Anup Kumar, he is known to you through this platform at least 2-3 times earlier. And he is heading the critical care division at the Baby Memorial Hospital, Calicut. Dr. Anil Satyadas from Medical College Hospital, Trivandrum. And he is an associate professor with the department. And he is heading the critical care division at the Medical College Trivandrum. And I'm so happy to see that Anil Satyadas also was able to rekindle interest in everybody of Trivandrum to have more interest put on critical care, which I was failing to do 2.5 decades back. And I welcome you, Dr. Anil Satyadas, Anup Kumar, Anjan Trikka, and J.V. Devatia. And well, all these people, Devatia, Trikka, Anup, and Anil Satyadas represent in various committees of the state government as well as the national government in COVID management. And we'll be doing the first part now, and the first part of the webinar will be handled by Dr. Arvind Narayan and Dr. Gopakumar. And my floor manager, or say executive director of the webinars, Dr. Sunny, should be introducing them and will be allowing them to speak on their areas. After that, we'll go on with our much awaited discussion on oxygen therapy through the panel discussions. Over to you.
Good evening, sir. Welcome everybody to this ICA webinar. We would like to have an announcement also, sir. We'll make the announcement regarding our annual day celebration also, sir.
Please go ahead.
Yeah. ICA webinars will be completing uninterrupted 1 year of activity. Last June 15th, we started. And without any exception, all Wednesdays, we had academic deliberations. So July 14th, we are coming out with a special edition of ICA webinar with special featured presentations by international leaders in anesthesia, as a mark of celebration of our ICA Academics Annual Day 2021. We are also planning for a live interactive quiz for postgraduates and residents in the latter part of the special edition webinar on July 14th. And coming back to today's session, I'm very happy to introduce both the speakers for the first session. And I think none other than Dr. Arvind Narayan is the best person to initiate our discussion on oxygen therapy, I believe. Dr. Arvind has been my senior colleague when I was working in Sultan Qaboos University, Muscat. He has got his anesthesia training from JIPMA. He had worked in Muscat, he had worked in Australia, and now he's back in India. And as far as I know, in clinical acumen and academic acumen, he is a special person and a passionate academician. I'm happy to introduce Dr. Arvind Narayan to ICA webinars. It's over to you, Dr. Arvind.
Very good evening to everybody. I'm humbled by Dr. Sanish's introduction. We have to dedicate ourselves to furthering our expertise and our research so that the community in general benefits from it. I hope I'm audible.
Dr. Sanish? Yes, please go ahead.
So I will start the screen sharing. We will dive into the topic without much of a delay. So oxygen therapy, I think, has been the one of the first chapters. In fact, most of the books would start off with gases in a primary topic, which needs to be understood by all who step into the field of anesthetics as such. So oxygen has been and will continue to be the life giver for all of us on Earth. There's no second option to that. Maybe in different forms, solid, liquid. I don't know solid whether it's feasible, but liquid and gas certainly yes. So we are going to, in the next 20 minutes, we are going to focus on the journey of oxygen from the factory to the hospital to the patient. Now, this is a journey which it undertakes, and most of us in clinical care would actually encounter or meet this journey right at the hospital level. And then we somehow facilitate it into the patient, up to the mitochondria to enable the life-sustaining processes. So it's a life-sustaining element, and we need to respect it, and we need to understand how it works. Most of us, through our medical training, read biochemistry, and we get to understand most of the cycles which happen. And then when we work in clinical care, we understand the importance of hypoxia management. So let's dive into it. Unfortunately or fortunately, oxygen has come back into the focus thanks to the media and to definitely certain on-the-ground issues which have brought it into focus for the past few months. And we are left with disturbing images of people scrambling for oxygen, which God has provided to us as 21% in the atmosphere. But in clinical care, the food industry, fish farms, lasers, heavy machinery, offshore drilling, tunneling, water treatment. But what has caught our fancy was, I think, the steel industry, since steel plants contributed to oxygen in the past month or so in a heavy way, and we get to understand, the common person understands the source. Oxygen in healthcare, I guess it's a no-brainer. Most of us know it's used for hypoxemia management. Is it used elsewhere? That's a good question. Acute resuscitation, perioperative care, in ventilation for driving number of equipments, pulmonary care, headache management, carbon monoxide poisoning, and the list goes on. We also see a lot of use behind the scenes in laboratory calibration systems and so on. So oxygen is something which is needed along with the other gases, nitrogen, carbon dioxide for laparoscopy, helium, and so on. But what emphasizes our need to understand is that the oxygen cascade, which is sort of necessary for life-sustaining cellular aerobic respiration, is basically what we all respiration, is basically what we all are ingrained into our DNA when we start into anesthetics. We read about the partial pressures, the stepwise drop, and which facilitates the flow of oxygen from the atmosphere to the alveoli to the cells. Dr. Gopakumar would be talking further about this, but this is an important cornerstone of management and understanding oxygen use in humans, the downstream oxygen cascade. Why downstream? Because I have had the privilege now to talk about what happens upstream. We have a similar cascade, and I would like to coin this so that we understand how oxygen flows into the hospital. And this is an important aspect of what we are trying to learn today. So upstream, it starts from the atmosphere, and we see the production and storage in the factory. Oxygen factories, specific gas factories, which are huge concerns, which actually synthesize a number of gases and run by private companies. You would see a lot of trademarks and private company names. I am not affiliated to any of them. It's a disclaimer. It's just that for visual reinforcement that I've used a lot of visuals in my presentation. The production and storage in large factories where different gases are liquefied, distilled, and separated out and purified. Oxygen factory. Then we'll focus on transport to the different hospitals and other healthcare centers. We'll focus on storage of the oxygen received in the hospital and healthcare setups. Then we'll look into the distribution of the gas in the hospital. Then we would go into the flow at the bedside. So let's remember that it's a cascade which is happening right from production to reach, to get the oxygen up to the patient care setup, which is the flow at the bedside. And then Dr. Gopakumar would continue from there in order to elaborate how this is taken to the patient and administered in the form of a therapy, the oxygen therapy, the all-important oxygen therapy. So quickly diving into oxygen production. A number of visuals here. You are free to grab the slides, no copyright. And you can use it to understand how things have been crystallized, basically from the atmosphere using energy. And now there's a big word on carbon footprint. So most companies have zero carbon mechanism to produce gas from the atmosphere. Thankfully, Mother Earth is not charging the companies for it, but they do charge us for this process of getting pure gases out of the atmosphere, transporting them through different means. Now, these are the large oxygen plants. Some of them, called air separation plants, can be commissioned in a smaller basis near larger cities or urban centers where the oxygen requirement is high, both for industry as well as for healthcare. That explains why the steel plants have a lot of oxygen with them, which was used in the current context when there was a shortage in the major cities. So these, all of them use primarily the liquefaction of oxygen under pressure and separation, purification, and storage. Some of them do use electrolysis from water as a source of oxygen, but that's a minimal route. Transport of oxygen. All of us know oxygen as a gas. Yes, it is transported in the form of compressed gas cylinders, which is the ubiquitous way we look at oxygen. But let's not forget that this transport in the last few months has happened by land, sea, and air. Sea transport normally does occur for offshore oil platforms when they need oxygen, and maybe certain Antarctic-based healthcare setups which need oxygen supply from the other continents. But the large-scale transfer has been facilitated in the past few months. We have seen oxygen express trains. We have seen caravans of oxygen trucks, both in the gas form as cylinders and also in the liquid form. In fact, the Indian Navy had been instrumental in getting huge ships, container ships filled with cryogenic containers, got from neighboring friendly countries who could spare some. And we have tided over the issue, hopefully, and hope the subsequent waves don't pressurize our oxygen supply system more. But it's worthwhile to note and to get to know about these systems so that we are ready with subsequent contingency measures for the next requirement whenever it comes by. Quickly coming to oxygen as a compressed gas, I have borrowed generously from certain textbooks just to bring into focus that all of us need to know how oxygen in compressed gases has been manifested into different types of cylinders, different sizes, different specifications, and each of them have different pressures in which the companies make it. And we need to understand it is in the form of a gas, and we need to understand how much of volume of oxygen is available. Since we administer oxygen in the form of liters per minute to patients, we need to understand how many liters of the gas is present in the cylinder. So please feel free to go through the slide in detail. I have put in a lot of information which helps us to quickly compute the type of oxygen, the amount of oxygen, How long will the cylinder last? A question which is integral to patient management. When we are stuck with sources, earlier it used to be only a problem of transport, wherein we have a definitive oxygen capacity for transporting a patient from A to B. But the past few months have seen that we need to do this much closer in all the COVID care centers, in the ICUs of large hospitals. And it cannot be taken for granted that oxygen available in a particular hospital will last forever. It doesn't. We need to understand this, that oxygen has to be administered as gas, and how many cylinders are available in a particular healthcare setting. What are the pressures? We need to be able to commute that using the pressure gauges, apply appropriate transformations, and try to use our calculators to figure out how many liters of oxygen we have, and then match it to the flow rates, the leaks, and how much of patient demand. And try to understand that this is the information which is core to our appropriate and optimal utilization of oxygen in healthcare settings. Oxygen cylinder, we have seen visuals of them being used as independent cylinders in hospitals, but that's not the usual way hospital systems work. They are all got into a manifold system called the oxygen bank. Since they are under higher pressure, a suitable system of pressure regulators have to be applied. The pressure has to be stepped down by the time it reaches the patient outlets in the oxygen in the OT or in the ICU to 50 to 55 PSI, and then subsequently using further regulators, it has to be got down and flow meters are used to administer it to the patient. So we have cylinder manifolds, which have large cylinders, which have a capacity of close to 6,500 to 7,000 liters. And then we have primary and secondary supplies. We need to have reserve supplies. Sometimes it's logical, and we have seen this time it's happening that cylinders are put into bundles or pallets where larger hospitals can procure them in the form of like wholesale supplies. And it's easier to connect, and it's easier to administer, and easier to replenish. So these are the different ways compressed oxygen is put into cylinders. Advantages: cylinders are portable. We are more used to them. A variety of connectors can be used, and they are refilled at the factory, but they're simple and cheap. And it can be used, but we have also seen the disadvantages. The capacity is limited, they are heavy, and the number of safety issues with respect to explosions, with respect to injuries, and so on. So it's a busy slide. A number of factors have been listed over there. Please take your time to go through it. But oxygen cylinder supply has been the backbone of most of the hospitals, especially in the tier two cities and the towns. So we need to understand them in detail. Liquid oxygen, it's another form of oxygen, which is medical grade, supplied by different companies. And they're stored in cryogenic liquid systems. They are complex, they sound complex, they are at higher pressures, they are at much lower temperatures. But why go into all the trouble to use liquid oxygen for hospital supply? Because it's less bulky and less costly than the equivalent capacity of high pressure gas storage. Since liquid expands to about 860 times liquid oxygen. So if I take about 1 cubic feet of liquid oxygen, it becomes 860 cubic feet when it's allowed to expand. And that's a major advantage. And most companies would, just like vaporizers, they would actually help us in setting up this and then supplying it and replenishing it. So how do we store the liquid oxygen in the hospitals? They are stored in huge containers. Most of us would have seen these huge containers. And they are filled with liquid oxygen by replenishment from trucks, which are again huge containers, which are double-walled, more like thermos flasks. They don't need much of a power, but they need to be under pressure. And at temperatures of minus 180 degrees, they are stored in the factories and then they are transported. But let's not forget that over a period of time, the oxygen liquid would slowly get converted to gas. And there is a leakage option. There's a pressure buildup inside that needs to be vented out. So if a healthcare system doesn't use enough oxygen, then commissioning such a system is going to be a waste of oxygen. But a system which uses a lot of oxygen, this system has to be connected to the pipeline system of the hospital so that the liquid constantly vaporizes. We use something called ambient atmosphere vaporizer, which is a number series of pipes. And the oxygen is just allowed to flow out, and the atmospheric temperature warms it up and makes it into a gas to be given into the pipeline system. These large containers do have a weighing machine system so that we can check out what is the weight and then calculate how much oxygen is remaining. These are again the same concept. 1 ml of this expands to 860 ml. So it's a good idea to keep them in liquid in the form of cylinders for not a very big hospital system. And the cylinders, again, are property of the respective companies. So there's a system of replenishing them and replacing them. They come in different sizes. Yet all of them cannot be, the liquid cannot be directly used. It has to be used through a pipeline system. So liquid oxygen, quickly summarizing the advantages, it's efficient in terms of space. It's actually stored at a lower pressure compared to the cylinder. No power supply is needed since it's a vacuum sealed insulated drum which is used for it. And it's cheaper to both deliver and to store as a liquid. But the initial equipment costs are high and there is some amount of wastage, but there's also safety concern of having such a huge bulk of oxygen kept in the vicinity of a hospital or a healthcare setup. So distribution, either it's liquid or a compressed gas, oxygen needs to be distributed through the hospital because modern hospitals don't use oxygen in only one place. As we listed earlier, there are different areas where they need to be given to, and it's done through the pipeline system, wherein the manifolds are connected to pressure regulator and a system of alarms and valves are created so that it's picked up whether there's any leakage, any damage. And we have to also monitor the amount of oxygen available for catering to the supplies of the hospital. So I won't go into the details of this, but most of us would have seen the ubiquitous gas pipeline system in most of the hospitals. What we see are the colorful pipes running across the wall. They're made of copper. They're color-coded. But let's not forget that these pipes are fed the respective gases. When I say respective gases, most hospitals use not only oxygen, the OT and the other areas which use nitrous oxide. So we need to understand that there's a risk of them intermingling, risk of leakage and so on. But most of the sources of oxygen, what we would see, are ultimately taken to the patient care areas from outside the hospital, from a gas plant or a manifold system, through the pipeline system, into the hospital, to the different areas of distribution. And at all points, we need to have alarms, we need to have fire extinguishing systems, we need understanding that the oxygen is something which aids burning and combustion. So it is a danger which you need to contend with. And it's a huge expense in terms of infrastructure. The additional thought which has come about in recent times is that we need to have a system. If this system fails, what is the fallback? So mobile oxygen systems should be interconnecting into the pipeline system so we can feed oxygen into it. If the main system, I recollect we had an accident in Nashik a few months back, wherein when the oxygen tanker was refilling, the entire system got shut down and a lot of patients lost their lives. So these are the issues which are learning curve for us, and we need to incorporate this in our advice to the designers and the hospital administrators when they design the pipeline system and monitor it. So safety systems come into an important focus when we realize that we are dealing with a number of gases, which is a lifesaver, which has somehow been transported and got to the hospital. But if you're not able to give it to the patient, ultimately, we are failing in our duty to oxygenate the patient. So this has to be monitored closely in terms of monitoring the different electronic systems and making sure the right gas goes to the right pipelines and meets the patient. So master alarms and then different index systems have been in vogue to make sure that oxygen is a gas which has given the highest priority, and it needs to be given ensured safe supply of oxygen is given to the patient. And we need to also monitor that it is indeed oxygen, because colorless gases, there's always a propensity of them having been contaminated and the concentration might be lower. Next comes an important aspect of oxygen concentrators, in-house systems, wherein if there is a problem with supply, that what we have seen this time happening in major cities, or if the hospital is in a remote location wherein it's very difficult to transport oxygen to and store them due to climatic reasons or weather reasons or whatever. So we need to have oxygen concentrators which sort of grab oxygen inside near the hospital and then filter it, make sure that it passes through a molecular sieve using something called pressure swing adsorption technology. And then it sort of circulates it, concentrates oxygen, removes vents of the nitrogen and carbon dioxide. And so there are some issues with this in terms of storage, in terms of the purity of oxygen available, where a maximum of 93% to 94%. Maximum being 96%, which can be obtained. There's a possibility of contamination with argon. And there's a possibility that power fluctuations can affect the synthesis of oxygen. So oxygen concentrator is always kept as a backup option. We have seen this technology come into our homes in the last few weeks or few months, when people who have had requirement due to COVID have got oxygen concentrators, which are much portable devices, work on similar technology, and which can make oxygen or purify it and concentrate it to a higher medical grade level, not 100%, but higher level. And this can be used in the domiciliary setting, which have been even otherwise done for pulmonary care. Future innovations, like in all systems,
seen shortages happening. We have seen an imbalance between demand and supply. We have not been able to estimate the needs and so on. So we need to have intelligent systems. You talk about anything now, even the fan which I'm using now works on a system which is enabled through my smartphone. So why not use the same system for oxygen monitoring? Yes, companies offer commercial solutions, and this is just some of them which I found. And these are basically sensors linked, and they use the Internet of Things. They pass information, and then they inform the company when there's a shortage and when there's going to be a... And then you can have barcode, just like supermarkets, you can have barcoding of cylinders and go about logistics of the cylinders can be maintained. Right, this is my last slide. I would like to, I think, finish up now. We are just about hitting 7:30 on my watch in Chennai. But recreational oxygen, as I included as a package of my talk towards the end, because this is how oxygen gets packaged. You know, whether it's this is definitely not medical grade, but there are companies who have been commercializing packaging of oxygen, maybe not fully understanding the risks which happens when you package oxygen in the form of a gas or a liquid and put them in portable sources. They run out eventually, but adding flavors to them and marketing them as in the form of oxygen spas or oxygen bars, maybe temporary oxygenation of patients, but this is not going to be the purview of anesthesiologists. We are just going to understand that oxygen has to be a commodity which needs to be used carefully. We have seen shortages happening even in the best of centers with the best of capabilities of logistics. And I think that amount of prudence should come into our clinical practice also in advising the hospital maintenance and the other systems to understand the gravity of oxygen and the demand and supply of it. Thank you so much, Dr. Sanish. I think over to you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Arvind. I really appreciate. Actually, it was not unexpected because you have promised me to deliver your talk exactly within the schedule, even if the pressures go up to, I remember it was 55 PSIG. Anyway, thank you very much for highlighting some different aspects of how you bring oxygen from the atmosphere, from the factory up to the patient care area. Thank you very much. Now, I think some questions are already there in the chat box. We'll discuss along with our panel discussion. And before we go on to the next phase of administering the oxygen we have collected from the atmosphere, from the factory, all the way down to the mitochondria, my teacher, my friend, my senior colleague, Dr. Gopakumar is waiting. I would like to keep him waiting for a minute more. Sorry for that. Because I thought I'll take this opportunity to remind you regarding our feedback forms in ICA webinars. So all the participants are eligible to get e-certificate of participation. The link for the feedback form will be circulated a little while later towards the latter half of our session. So you need to fill your name here. Remember, whatever name you put there will appear on your e-certificate. The email, whatever you give there, that certificate will be delivered to that email ID. We are not responsible for any spelling mistakes over that, because last week I found many of the emails bouncing because some people are casual while entering the email ID. Then we have asked you for some feedback regarding our particular sessions of the webinar and our ICA webinars as a whole. So we would like to receive your feedback. We are on the lookout for continual improvement. We'll pursue our efforts to bring up more academic content in a better interactive way. And now I would like to welcome Gopakumar sir, who is a much beloved teacher. I think when I circulated the webinar flyer from different parts of India, actually I got feedback saying that they are looking forward to Dr. Gopakumar's lecture because some of them had nostalgic moments of him asking questions. I don't know whether troubling with questions during their term with Dr. Gopakumar. He is a passionate teacher. He does cardiac anesthesia more. And more, I think the simple introduction would be a passionate teacher who would like to think in minute terms, like he mentioned, we'll take oxygen up to the mitochondria. We'll see how it happens today. It's over to you, Dr. Gomagumar, for your lecture. Yes, sir, your slides are visible. You can go to the first slide, sir.
Good evening, everybody. And thank you, Sanish, for your kind words. And thanks, BRK sir, for inviting me for the ICA webinar. Am I audible to you?
Yes.
Yes, sir, very much.
So my topic is oxygen therapy. So as you know, the single cell organisms like amoeba acquires oxygen directly from the environment and expels carbon dioxide directly. But in human being, there are so many obstacles. This was Dr. Arvind mentioning oxygen cascade. These are the obstacles in human being for oxygen to travel from the atmosphere to the mitochondria. Right from the atmosphere to the alveolus, there is the long airway. Then comes the pulmonary capillary membrane, the respiratory membrane. Then comes the arterioles, systemic arteries, systemic capillaries. Then the cell wall, the cell membrane to the mitochondria. So there are so many obstacles, and while facing each obstacle, the partial pressure of oxygen, which was around 160, that is 159 at the atmosphere, falls down to 22 to 4 at the level of mitochondria. This has some basic physics. This is Dalton's law of partial pressure, which states in a mixture of gases, the total pressure is equal to the sum of the partial pressures of its components. Atmosphere is a mixture of gases like nitrogen, oxygen, and other trace gases like carbon dioxide, argon, and water vapor. So this is the composition of atmospheric air. Oxygen constitutes around 20.9% of the atmosphere. Nitrogen, it is 78.1%. And carbon dioxide, argon, water vapor, and other gases constitute around 1%. So if you calculate the partial pressures of each gas according to the Dalton's law, so you multiply the total atmospheric pressure, that is 760 millimeters of mercury, into the volume percentage. For oxygen, it comes to 179 millimeters of mercury. So that is a partial pressure of oxygen in the atmosphere. So once it traverses the airway, it gets hydrated. Due to the warming and hydration, water vapor is added. So around 6.2% of water vapor is added to the inspired gas by the time it reaches the alveoli. And the alveolar carbon dioxide also dilutes the inspired mixture. So the composition of the alveolar gases, oxygen constitutes around 13.3%, nitrogen 75.2%, and the carbon dioxide 5.3%, which was around 0.04% in the atmosphere. And water vapor added, when it gets saturated, it is 6.2%. So if you translate it into partial pressures, then the partial pressure of oxygen is 101. So from 159, by the time it reaches the alveoli, it reduces to 101. So this is the alveoli where the gas exchange takes place. And this is the alveolar capillary membrane. From the alveolar side, there is alveolar epithelium, alveolar basement membrane, interstitial space, capillary basement membrane, capillary endothelium, and the RBCs. Oxygen is carried in the by the hemoglobin and in the dissolved form in the blood. And this is what is happening at the level of the lung between the alveoli and the pulmonary capillaries. You can see the systemic venous end of the pulmonary capillary, which has a partial pressure of oxygen of 40 and a partial pressure of carbon dioxide of 45. And the pulmonary venous end of the capillary, that is partial pressure of oxygen is there is 100 and partial pressure of carbon dioxide is 40. So the reverse happens and at the level of the cells, oxygen is diffusing into the cell and carbon dioxide, the byproduct of metabolism, diffuses back to the systemic capillaries. This is how oxygen is carried from the at the level of the alveoli to the cell. There are two forms, as I said, one in the simple solution form, that is 0.003 ml per millimeter of partial pressure of oxygen. That is, if it is around at the partial pressure of oxygen in the arterial blood is around 100, so it comes to 0.3 ml per 100 ml of blood. And in combination of hemoglobin, it is each gram of hemoglobin can carry 1.34 ml of oxygen. So if you calculate the oxygen content of arterial blood, the formula is each gram of hemoglobin carries 1.34. So you multiply the hemoglobin percentage with 1.34 and you multiply that with percentage saturation. And you add the dissolved part of the oxygen, that is partial pressure of arterial partial pressure of oxygen into 0.003. So if the hemoglobin is 15 and partial pressure of oxygen is 100 and saturation is 98, it comes to 1.34 into 15 into 98 by 100 plus the dissolved 0.3 comes to around 20 ml. So this is the amount of oxygen carried by 100 ml of blood. So oxygen flux, what we mean by oxygen flux is the amount of oxygen leaving the left ventricle every minute. So now you know how much oxygen is carried by 100 ml of blood. So 1000 ml carries 200 ml. So one cardiac output, that is 5 liters, 5000 ml of blood carries around 1000 ml of oxygen from the left ventricle every minute, out of which 250 ml of oxygen is utilized in the tissues. So now we shall see what is hypoxia and hypoxemia. Hypoxia, we mean by inadequate oxygen delivery at tissue level. And hypoxemia is deficiency of oxygen in the arterial blood. So you can classify hypoxia according to the partial pressure of oxygen. Mild is PaO2 from 80 to 60 and moderate is from 60 to 40 and severe is less than 40 millimeters of mercury. So there are four types of hypoxia: hypoxic, anemic hypoxia, stagnant hypoxia, and histotoxic hypoxia. Hypoxic hypoxia of oxygen in arterial blood is insufficient. And anemic hypoxia is the decreased ability to transport oxygen. That can happen when the hemoglobin is low, or there is even though the hemoglobin value is normal, it can be carbon monoxide poisoning, methemoglobinemia, sulfhemoglobinemia, all of which reduces the potential of hemoglobin to carry oxygen. Stagnant hypoxia occurs when there is decreased delivery of oxygen to tissue cells as a result of insufficient blood flow. And the systemic conditions causing stagnant hypoxia are situations like cardiac failure. And locally, it can happen when there is local disruption in the arterial blood supply. Histotoxic hypoxia occurs when tissues are unable to properly utilize oxygen despite adequate oxygen supply. That happens when cyanide poisoning. So what happens when there is hypoxia? Cessation of oxidative phosphorylation, which leads to anaerobic pathways of metabolism and which is inefficient and leads to acidosis. So this is the role of oxygen in metabolism. The glucose gets metabolized inside the cell and the first step is glycolysis, which happens in the cytosol. So it generates two ATPs and two NADH. and glucose is converted to pyruvate. That step doesn't need oxygen, but transport of the next step happens in the mitochondria to transport pyruvate and ADP to the inside mitochondria. It needs energy, and ATP is oxygen is utilized. So this is the next step of glucose metabolism. The pyruvate enters the mitochondria and it is converted to acetyl-CoA, and which enters the Krebs cycle, and ATPs are produced, and around 38 glycolysis and used, and around 38 glycolysis and Krebs cycle produces around 38 ATPs, out of which 7 to 8 ATPs are utilized for transportation and things like that. And finally, around 30 ATP net gain is around 30 ATPs. So the mechanism of hypoxic hypoxemia, the usual mechanisms are, the first one is decrease in inspired partial pressure of oxygen. And next is hypoventilation. And third is impaired diffusion from the alveoli to the capillary blood. And the fourth cause is ventilation perfusion mismatching. And to that extreme, it can cause, it is due to shunting of blood from the systemic veins to the left side of heart, that is the arterial blood. This is the ideal lung where the alveolar gas composition is perfectly matched with the blood leaving the alveoli, that is the pulmonary capillary blood leaving the alveoli. That is PO200 is exactly diffused to the pulmonary capillary blood. PCO2 of the ideal lung capillary is 40. So these are the possible alveolo-capillary combinations inside the lung. That is a normal unit where the ventilation and perfusion are perfectly matched. That is the V by Q ratio is 1. The dead space, there is ventilation, but there is no perfusion. So V by Q is infinity. And in low V by Q areas, what we mean is the ventilation is not perfectly matched with perfusion. So there is more ventilation, less ventilation and more perfusion. So that is low V by Q areas. The V by Q ratio is less than 1. And in true shunt, there is no ventilation at all, and there is only perfusion, and the systemic venous blood is carried directly to the left atria without any gas exchange. That is V by Q ratio is 0. This is a shunt equation. I'm not going into the details. But this is important, the alveolar to arterial PO2 gradient, that is, we get it from the alveolar gas equation. That is, alveolar partial pressure of oxygen is equal to the FiO2 into barometric pressure minus partial pressure of saturated water vapor, that is PB minus PH2O minus arterial carbon dioxide partial pressure divided by respiratory quotient. And so you substitute the values and you will get the alveolar partial pressure of oxygen. What is the, where should we know the alveolar partial partial pressure of oxygen? By getting the alveolar partial pressure of oxygen, you can calculate the alveolar to arterial partial pressure of oxygen gradient. So if, and by that, you can diagnose the cause of hypoxemia. Usually the alveolar to arterial gradient is less than 15 when you breathe air, and it increases linearly with the age and FiO2. And this is how we approach the patient with hypoxemia. When there is hypoxemia, that is when you see the ABG and you see a lesser amount of arterial partial pressure of oxygen, you see whether the partial pressure of carbon dioxide is increased. Then if it is increased, then you can diagnose it as a situation of hypoventilation. And when there is hypoventilation, you calculate the alveolar partial pressure of oxygen and you see the alveolar to arterial partial pressure of oxygen difference. And if there is no difference, there is a pure hypoventilation. And if the difference is also there, it is a combination of hypoventilation plus ventilation perfusion mismatch. And if the partial pressure of carbon dioxide is normal, normal, and if there is alveolar to arterial partial pressure of oxygen gradient, you see whether it is correctable with oxygen. If it is not correctable with oxygen, it is true shunt. And if it is correctable with oxygen, it is, you can diagnose it as ventilation perfusion mismatch. And if there is no alveolar to arterial partial pressure of oxygen gradient, there is the diagnosis is low inspired concentration of oxygen. This is low FAO2 and correspondingly low inspired PO2. So we move on to the topic proper, that is oxygen therapy. So we, with oxygen therapy, we aim at increasing oxygen content in arterial blood by raising partial pressure of oxygen in inspired air. That is, we are actually, what we are doing is we are increasing the partial pressure of inspired oxygen, that is PaO2, by increasing fraction of oxygen in the inspired air. That is, we are increasing the FaO2 and thereby we are increasing the PaO2. Another method is raising the absolute pressure, that is the raise the pressure above the atmospheric pressure. That is hyperbaric oxygen therapy. That we are not include, that is not included in today's discussion. So these are the goals of oxygen therapy. So in acute hypoxemia, the British Medical Journal has recommended that the, you should aim for a oxygen saturation of 94%. That is from 94 to 96, that is around 94%. And in chronic hypoxemia, you aim for a saturation of 88 to 92%. These are the goals of oxygen therapy. So now we shall discuss about oxygen delivery systems. Generally, the oxygen delivery systems can be classified into two, that is variable performance systems and fixed performance systems. So how we differentiate into two is with the peak inspiratory flow rate. A healthy person with a normal ventilatory pattern, suppose the patient is having tidal volume of 500 ml with a respiratory rate of 20 per minute and with a normal IE ratio, that is 1:2. So the inspiratory for a 20, if the respiratory rate is 20 per minute, each breath is, each respiratory cycle is 3 seconds. So if you, the ratio is, IE ratio is 1:2, then the inspiratory times comes to 1 second and the expiratory time 2 seconds. So the 500 ml of inspired tidal volume, the patient is taking in 1 second. So if you calculate the speed, it comes to 30,000 ml in 60 seconds. So that is the peak inspiratory flow rate. So it is 30 liters per minute. That is the speed with which we are inspiring a 500 ml tidal volume when you breathe at a rate of 20 per minute. So by variable performance system, we mean that they are low flow systems. They are not satisfying the peak inspiratory flow needs of the patient. We have, now we know what is the peak inspiratory flow required for the patient. And any system which is supplying flows less than that is what we call variable performance systems. Any system which supplies peak inspiratory flow needs of the patient or above that, we call it as fixed performance systems. So these low variable performance systems, there is air dilution, the rest of the tidal volume is satisfied with the air dilution, and FaO2 depends on the rate and depth of respiration. The systems we use in the variable performance systems are the nasal cannulas and simple oxygen mask and the oxygen mask with bag. Nasal cannula is the most commonly used device. It's very comfortable and convenient, and it uses the anatomic reservoir, that is the nose, nasopharynx and the oropharynx as the reservoir. And the anatomic reservoir comes to 1/3 of the anatomical dead space. The anatomical dead space is around 150 ml. So 1/3 of it is around 50 ml. That is the anatomical reservoir. So each liter of this, you know, where you usually we use flows of 1 liter to 6 liter with the in nasal cannula. So each liter, if you are using 1 liter per minute, the estimated FiO2 will be around 24%. And for each liter, it adds 4%. That is, for 2 liters, it is 28%. Three, it is 32. 4, 36. And if you are using 5 liters, it is 40. And for 6 liters, it is 44%. The flow rate above 6 liters, there is patient discomfort, nasal drying and bleeding, and is not acceptable. So again, if a patient is breathing with a tidal volume of 500 ml, respiratory rate 20 per minute, the inspiratory time there comes 1 second and expiratory time 2 seconds. And we have seen that the anatomical reservoir is 50 ml. If you are giving a 6 liters per minute flow in a nasal cannula, if you calculate the speed, then it comes to 100 ml per second. So most of the expiratory flow occurs during the first 1.5 seconds, and the expiratory time is 2 seconds. So the 0.5 seconds is the expiratory pause. The 100% of oxygen completely fills the anatomic reservoir during the last 0.5 seconds of expiration. So the anatomical reservoir is fully saturated by that time. So next inspiration consists of 50 ml of 100% oxygen from the anatomic reservoir and 100 ml of oxygen 100 ml of 100% oxygen from the cannula, and the rest of the tidal volume is satisfied with the air. So 350 ml of air, that is 20% oxygen from room air, it comes to around 70 ml of pure oxygen. So if you are adding that, the 500 ml of tidal volume contains 220 ml of oxygen. So if you calculate the percentage, it comes to 44%. So that is, if you are giving 6 liters through the nasal cannula, the FiO2 the patient getting will be for around 44%. Since it is a variable performance system, you can say it is only around, not the, it varies depending on the patient's inspiratory pattern. So a patient receiving oxygen through the nasal cannula. And next thing is simple face mask. Here you are adding more reservoir. The reservoir, the anatomic reservoir of 50 ml plus the mask reservoir of 100 to 200 ml. But here, since it is covered, minimum flow must exceed 5 liters per minute to avoid rebreathing of carbon dioxide. So if you are giving 5 to 6 liters through the simple face oxygen mask, the FiO2 will be around 40%. And if you are giving 6 to 7 liters, it is 50%, and 7 to 8 liters, it is 60%. This is a simple oxygen mask. Next is non-rebreathing oronasal mask. It incorporates one-way valves in addition to reservoir bags. So when the patient breathes in, it will be directly from the oxygen reservoir, the oxygen stored in that bag. So it will be almost pure oxygen. So you can achieve a FiO2 up to 0.9. So there is, since the expiration goes directly to the atmosphere through the valve, there is no rebreathing of carbon dioxide.
Oh.
So this is the non-rebreathing mask, NRBM, with the valves. Now we move on to the fixed performance systems, that is high flow systems. Here, what we were discussing is they satisfies the peak inspiratory flow needs of the patient. That is, if for a 70 kg man, it gives around more than 30 liters per minute. It delivers oxygen flows that exceeds patient's minute ventilation by 3 to 4 times. That comes to peak inspiratory flow needs. The most commonly used is the Venturi masks. It is based on, as you know, it is based on Bernoulli's principle. Oxygen flowing at rapid velocity through a restricted orifice creates a negative pressure and enrains air. FiO2 depends on the size of that orifice and the air entrainment ports. You can see in the picture that the air entrainment ports and the oxygen jet port. So this is the air entrainment port. Very useful where exact FiO2s are crucial, especially in patients who are having COPD receiving oxygen. So this is a 24% Bendy mask. The recommended flow you have, you can see it is written on the adapter, that is 2 liters per minute, and you can see the air entrainment ports, port and the oxygen port. So these are the different percentage Bendy masks. 24%, that is 0.24, providing 0.24 FiO2. The recommended oxygen flow is 2 liters. And the air entrainment comes to 46. And the total flow it provides is 48 liters. And if you see the 60% mask, the recommended oxygen flow is 15 liters. And the air entrainment is around 50 liters per minute at a 1:1 air oxygen ratio. And the total flow comes to 30 liters per minute. So if you are calculating the FiO2 in a 60% Bendy mask, the oxygen flow is 15 liters per minute and the air entrainment is 15 liters per minute. So the total flow comes to 15 plus 15, 30 liters per minute. And the total oxygen in this 30 liters is 15 liters of pure oxygen we are supplying and the 3 liters of oxygen in the 15 liters of air. So if you add 15 plus 3, it comes to 18 liters. And the total flow is 30 liters, so 18 by 30 into 100 comes to 60%. So now we move on to the other fixed performance high flow system, that is high flow nasal oxygen. A typical high flow nasal oxygen system consists of a flow generator, an active heated humidifier, a single limb heated circuit, and a nasal cannula. According to the monitored oxygen concentration, FiO2 can be titrated with flows up to 60 to 80 liters per minute. So this is the high flow nasal catheter unit. You can see the flow meter with the blender, air oxygen blender, and the active humidifier. And this is the heated inspiratory circuit, and this is the nasal cannula through which the patient gets the oxygen. It has a small pliable nasal prongs, warming and humidification of these are the advantages of high flow nasal oxygen. Nasal prongs are small and pliable compared to the your usual nasal prongs we use for low flow oxygen. And there is warming and humidification of secretions and washout of nasopharyngeal dead space. And continuous positive, it provides a dynamic continuous positive airway pressure and patient is getting high flow rates, satisfying the peak inspiratory flow needs. Several studies have reported improved patient comfort with the HFNC system when compared with the conventional low flow oxygen delivered through the nasal cannula and high flow oxygen delivered through the face mask. Increased humidification results in increased water content in mucus, which can facilitate secretion removal and may also decrease the work of breathing and avoid airway desiccation and epithelial injury. It helps to wash out of upper airway dead space from the delivery of a large amount of oxygen, can improve the efficiency of ventilation and enhance oxygen delivery. Permits a higher fraction of minute ventilation to participate in alveolar gas exchange by washing out the anatomical dead space. So in this picture, you can see how it washes out the anatomical dead space. So here, this is the anatomical dead space when we breathe normally, because during expiration, the expired gas will collect over here. But when you are using a high flow nasal cannula, it continuously flushes this area and washes out the carbon dioxide from this area. So during the next inspiration, patient will be getting the gas, oxygen containing pure gas from this anatomical reservoir. So there is reduction in the anatomical dead space. So it provides a continuous positive airway pressure. In general, every increase of 10 liters per minute of flow yields approximately 0.7 centimeters of airway pressure when the mouth is closed, and 0.35 centimeters of water when the mouth is open. Patients in respiratory distress generate high inspiratory flow rates that exceeds flow rates of standard oxygen equipment, resulting in entrainment of room air and a reduction in the delivery of the set FiO2. The rate of flow in HFNC exceeds that of patient, resulting in an FAO2 that is more reliably delivered. But open mouth breathing or breathing during exercise will mitigate this advantage. But these are the other modes of oxygen delivery. NIV is very important, but since the time is not permitting, I am not going into the details of non-invasive ventilation. The other modes of oxygen delivery are the extracorporeal membrane oxygenation, that is ECMO, and hyperbaric oxygen is out of our discussion. These are the other forms of oxygen delivery used in pediatric practice, that is oxygen hood. It's a transparent enclosure surrounding the head of the infant. It has continuous humidified oxygen more than 7 liters per minute is continuously given through that hood. And another one is oxygen tent. It is an electrically powered appliance that incorporates an air circulation system and provide temperature control. So now we shall discuss something about the oxygen toxicity also. The irony is the substance that is of vital importance to sustenance of life is also capable of causing death. So this is a mechanism by which oxygen causes pulmonary oxygen toxicity. The intracellular oxygen metabolism involves reduction of oxygen to water with addition of an electron at each step. That is, step one is superoxide molecule, that is oxygen plus an electron, O2 minus. Step two is hydrogen peroxide. Step three is hydroxyl ion. And step four is water. And the superoxide molecule and the hydroxyl ion are highly reactive, capable of damaging cell membranes, mitochondria, and enzymes, which finally leads to respiratory distress syndrome. So another complication of oxygen therapy is denitrogenation absorption atelectasis. When you use high concentration of oxygen, oxygen replaces nitrogen in the alveoli. So if you're giving 100% oxygen, there will be no nitrogen at all. So when there is a bronchial constriction or a narrowing, oxygen gets completely absorbed from the part of lung downstream to obstruction, and which leads to collapse of the alveoli. So another complication of oxygen therapy is depression of ventilation, especially in patients with COPD. When you use high oxygen concentration, it takes away the hypoxic drive. So another complication when you use it for preterm infants, that is post-conceptional age of less than 44 weeks, and if the FAO2 causes a PAO2 of more than 80 millimeters of mercury for more than 3 hours, it can cause retrolental fibroplasia. So these are some practical guidelines to prevent pulmonary oxygen toxicity. As far as possible, do not administer 100% oxygen for more than 12 hours and 80% oxygen for more than 24 hours and 60% oxygen for more than 36 hours. Hypoxemia resulting from low ventilation perfusion mechanisms usually is reversed with less than 50% inspired oxygen. Absorption atelectasis, denitrogenation absorption atelectasis tends to counteract improvement in arterial oxygenation from FAO2 values greater than 0.5. So there, give consideration to improve ventilation perfusion mismatch when responsive hypoxemia requires more than 50% of oxygen with other means, that is antibiotics, chest physiotherapy, positive end expiratory pressure, fluid restrictions, and diuretic therapy, things like that. So as far as possible, improve the ventilation perfusion mismatch first so that you can reduce the FAO2 to less than 50% as early as possible to prevent pulmonary oxygen toxicity. But never withhold high concentration of inspired oxygen during resuscitation, periods of acute cardiopulmonary instability, and patient transport where there is very fluctuating oxygen levels in the blood. So you can't predict when the patient is going into hypoxia. So they're always sure that your patient is getting adequate oxygen. So never withhold high concentrations during resuscitation and periods of acute cardiorespiratory instability and transport. Oxygen is a drug. When appropriately used, it is extremely beneficial, and when misused or abused, it is potentially harmful. Unfortunately, the detrimental effects of oxygen are seldom recognized as such. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. You rightly pointed out that oxygen is a drug, and I expect the audience to put their questions in the chat regarding oxygen therapy per se. Thank you very much, sir, for your wonderful lecture, where you have been trying to give the visualization of what happens when oxygen gets transported across the alveolus into the circulation at the tissue level, at what happens at the mitochondrial level, and when and how oxygen should be used. Being a drug, I think in modern era, we have a good number of gadgets to administer oxygen. You have mentioned that also. Sir, with your permission, we'll proceed to part two of today's webinar, where we'll bring in COVID-19 into the perspective. And it's over to Radhakrishnan, sir, to initiate the panel discussion. Over to you, sir. Sir, your mic is muted.
Okay, thank you. Could I be heard?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Arvind and Gopakumar, for highlighting on the production of oxygen and how it's being carried and what is the usual oxygen therapy which is carrying on today. And as we know, oxygen is a drug. There is a drug essentially needed in COVID-19 management. As on deck, oxygen is the only drug which is useful, and all the drugs are supplementary or say supportive or preventive. And now we know very well that during the metabolic process, a particular amount of oxygen is needed for the cell to carry on its metabolism. During some complexities, as often happens with any particular disease process or with any accelerated physiological process, oxygen level available in the tissue will not be enough. If there is impairment or deficiency in the production or availability of oxygen, the cell starts functioning poorly. That means dead cell starts dying. And at a point of time, when the oxygen level is much less, the cell dies. In fact, our role everywhere is to find out when the cell action, or say when the cell metabolism, or say through the cell metabolism, the combined activity of the organ system is failing, we have to intervene and give oxygen. And today we are discussing in COVID scenario, what has happened. In COVID scenario, we know we are trying very hard to give oxygen and support the patient with adequate amount of oxygen. Well, we have enough oxygen in the country. We know the technology. We know how to store, how to transport, and how to give regulated oxygen supply. But unfortunately, the supply or the availability is limited to the normal times. But at present times, the requirement has gone fivefold. And the situation is really wild. We are not able to cope. So our effort at this stage, how we could save even each ml of oxygen, and every healthcare professional should know how we should judiciously use the oxygen. So we will go with the discussion and on certain aspects which is not understood well, and probably our elite discussants, Dr. Jigidivetia,
Anjendrika, Anil Kumar, Anil Satyadas, Gopakumar, and Arvind may be able to tell us what is the best answer to every particular solution which we rather face across. And we are moving this particular discussion in a focused manner. On every particular focus, we are having some particular problem which is highlighted. And our panelist is going to give their answer. And probably that answer is the best in the country. And that's the one which is going to highlight us with better knowledge. We'll start with this, Dr. Divetia and Dr. Einstein. The question is that, did we had any oxygen therapy guidelines in the past? When I was a postgraduate student 45 years earlier, only protocol which I learned or I was taught was one, that hypoxia with a hypercapnic failure and hypoxia with a hypercapnic failure, which he used to label as type 1 respiratory failure and type 2 respiratory failure. For the type 1 respiratory failure, we are allowed to give any amount of oxygen. Whereas for the type 2 respiratory failure, we are allowed to give only greater oxygen delivery. Is it the same thing even now being continued? Or is there any change in the guidelines which you hold? And I'm sure from last March to today, June 2021, WHO has given some sort of protocols, ICMR is giving protocols, and National Institute of Health is giving some protocols. And Dr. Devetia and Dr. Anshan is going to highlight on this particular area. Dr. Devetia, Dr. Anshan, please.
Yeah. So, good evening, sir. I'm Dr. Devetia. Thank you for inviting me to this very important and innovative program. So, like you mentioned, you know, hypoxia was always considered bad and lots of oxygen was considered good. And for many, many years, till almost 20, 30 years ago, the paradigm was that you should, whatever you do, you should aim for normal blood gases. This is in the setting, at least not in the non-COPD, non-type. So in hypoxic respiratory failure, you should aim for normal blood gases. That is a PO2, which is more than 80 and a CO2, which is less than 50. And I think two big changes have come about. One is protective lung ventilation sort of came in. And, you know, so once we said we had to protect the lungs, we had to give less tidal volumes, we had to give lower plateau pressures, and we had to give, and instead of achieving normal blood gases, we started saying we should have safe blood gases, something which is not dangerous for the patient, but which is not normal. So we revised our oxygenation targets to a saturation of 88 to 95%. And PCO2, we were saying we could have some sort of permissive hypercapnia up to a pH of 7.2 or something. So that was the first step. So in order to protect the lung and to give less vigorous ventilation, we started accepting lower PO2 and higher CO2 targets. So that was one very important change. The second change has come in the last few years is where we recognize that even hyperoxia may not be good for the patient. So just having a PO2 of 200 and a saturation of 100%, we all used to feel very nice and we used to be very happy that our patient is doing well. But maybe the high PO2 and a high saturation is not very good for the patient. So again, we've had to deliberately come down on the oxygenation targets, again, to maintain a safe oxygenation with a saturation of, say, anywhere upwards of 90%. And like you mentioned, the WHO gives a particular target. I think it says around 94 in for most patients. Then the ICMR says 92 to 96. I think the recent guidelines have said something like 93% should be an oxygenation target. NIH says about 92 to 96% should be a SpO2. Now, these are in most normal patients where you can easily achieve, but sometimes where we can't achieve this, when patients who are sick, we are even, as long as the patient remains more or less stable, we are even tolerating lower targets of 85%, 88% saturation. So I think this has been the big change in the way we've looked at oxygen and even carbon dioxide in the last 20 years or so.
So coming to COVID scenario, like in the beginning of the COVID time, like last February, March and on, there were lots of enthusiastic discussion regarding having negative pressure rooms or cabinets.
Can I add something?
Yes.
My name is Anjan Trikha. I'm from New Delhi, Delhi, and we have a dedicated 250-bedded COVID center at Ames. And we had a first patient on 3rd of April last year. And that was the time when people were so afraid that they were, the private hospitals and corporate hospitals had said no to COVID. So it has been rightly said that hyperoxia is a big no, and permissive hypercapnia is a big yes. And WHO and ICMR have been changing guidelines. But the bottom line here is that guidelines are not godline. The guidelines made by NHS are happening there, are comfortable. You follow those guidelines because they have a X amount of ratio between patient and nurse everywhere else. In India, it's a different ballgame. What can be true in Bombay may not be true in Delhi. What is true in Delhi may not be true in Meerut, which is 150 miles from Delhi. So we have been insisting in our, we were asked by the government of India to have eICUs, and we've done about 100 of them with various medical institutions in the country, that you don't go to values which ICMR tells you. See what is best at your area. They just give you a type of a guideline, right? It is 92 to 96. But in your case, if you don't have a single nurse on a floor, or maybe you have one nurse for 40 patients, see to it that you are on the side that the patient is more comfortable. So whatever numbers Dr. Divetia has said are perfectly fine. But these guidelines have changed after the second surge. When the first surge came in, we were still comfortable at 95, 96. We were very apprehensive at 92, 90. But with the second surge, people went around whole of Delhi with a saturation of 88, 90 in their cars. You've seen those photographs. You've seen those videos with cylinders in the cars. So then when we came out as a official piece of number was that if you are having a saturation of 92, don't panic. Go and find a hospital. But then if you are at your house and you were at 94, 96, be comfortable and start looking for hospital. So that's how it has changed over the last 1.5 years. Hyperoxia, big no. Permissive hypercapnia, perfectly fine. But then permissive hypercapnia is in an ICU setting. And mind you, where are the people who are working in the ICU? Where are the doctors who can treat in the ICU? I'm working with residents from pathology, forensic medicine, anatomy, physiology. There's a huge, huge problem. So you manage the numbers as per the team you have. This is what I want to put across.
Thank you. During the peak, you will have a more modified protocol to cater, give the best to the maximum number of people, rather than you limit the number of people you take care of, where you can stick to the standard guidelines.
The question is not that. During the first surge, everywhere in the world, they were coming out with negative pressure cabinets, special devices for intubation, and promoting, it's always aerosols. Now it is combined with droplet. All these things are reasonable. And the first area approach towards the management has changed. I really doubt anywhere in the country, the negative pressure cabinets or special devices are being followed. What is your opinion, Dr. Anjan?
What I tell you is, yes, again, I come back to our own experience. We've had about a total of about 14,000 patients in my hospital, and the whole AIIMS, we would have about 22,000. These things came in fashion. As a matter of fact, you would be surprised to know that there were a lot of people in Italy and France who were trying to donate these kind of things to our country, and where we had to come down and say, no, we didn't need it. And then we had Indian manufacturers who came out with these kind of foods, because initially nobody knew what the disease was. There was a fear of going from fomites. There was a fear from going into from aerosols. So now we've really become more wiser. And for us, the best part was that we didn't even have a negative pressure ICU. We had to convert a trauma center to a COVID center. So other than one ICU, which was 12-bedded, the rest were all wards. So we had to improvise to create a negative pressure in that whole hall or a whole kind of a room. So the only way out was that we had huge exhaust fans put up so that we could have a flow of air going out, and the flow of air which was going out was not near a parking lot, not near a kitchen and all that stuff. And these hoods, we had simulated sessions to intubate through these hoods. We have a high fidelity simulation center, and we decided that we'll take all the residents, because the patients are just trying to come in. They were gradually coming in, and we couldn't do what they are showing. Most of the times, if you had to give a GA, you would remove this hood and put in a tube. But here, what we were happy with, that we had no problems in having level 4 PPEs. Until now, we have not dearth of level 4 PPEs. And we had our issues about fogging, but we never used any of these devices. They were made, they were tried on simulated mannequins, but they really never were used. And we never had the time to make a negative pressure ICU because there was a lockdown and we didn't have workers. Money was not a criteria. We had the space available. We had a couple of centers which were not in use, but we couldn't find any workers to make into this thing. No industry was coming forward to it.
Was negative pressure suits?
Sorry?
Instituted. Was negative pressure in these negative pressure cubicles or negative pressure rooms, was it built anywhere in the country? Was it followed anywhere in our country?
Yes, there are a couple of areas in corporate hospitals where they have negative pressure kind of things, where they do some solid organ transplants. There, and then subsequently we have been given proposals to make them, and they quote those hospitals. I really don't know. We've really not come in touch with them, but we know that we will not be in a position to have them during these lockdown periods. But they are ideal, and I am very sure that 99% of the places, this kind of a system doesn't exist. I don't know, what does Dr. Devetia think about it? A negative pressure ICU system for all patients, or for all ward patients even who are infected, generating aerosols in HDUs.
So, you know, when we had our ICU built, we had a provision to sort of reverse the flows. And, you know, in few rooms, in 3 or 4 single rooms, we were able to do that. So, but when you have so many patients to handle in the ICU, I think even if you cohort all your positive patients in one room, it's good enough. It doesn't matter whether it's positive pressure or negative pressure. If you have to have a mix of suspect patients or patients, you know, some who may be positive, who may be negative, then, you know, we put those patients in those single rooms with a negative airflow, so that, you know, we don't potentially infect other patients. And it's not such a big deal. I think if you don't have that kind of room, it's quite all right. If you have, it's fantastic. You do all your intubation and aerosol generating procedures there. But if you don't have, it's okay. You know, in the beginning, we also didn't have very good PPE, and we are not sure of what we are dealing with. So everyone in a state of panic, and, you know, anything which helped, we were trying to do. And we were actually panicking more because we didn't have negative pressure rooms and negative pressure OTs. But at the end, you know, we sort of got round to it. And with adequate PPE, cohorting of patients in one sort of area, it doesn't seem to be a big problem. And these aerosol boxes and those things, you know, we got lots of donations, and we did all sorts of innovations. We got protocols. We found that it was actually more difficult to intubate with those things. We also found that, you know, when you remove those boxes, the inside is laden with whatever particles or aerosols are there, and that can contaminate this thing. And I think within less than a month, we stopped using those things altogether in the first wave itself. So, and ever since then, we've not used these devices. I know there was a lot of innovation, and, you know, they were sort of more viral than the virus itself, these boxes on social media. But at the end of the day, we didn't think they were useful. And I, like you mentioned, I don't think many people are using them now at all.
Thank you for the frank opinion on the matter. Because
government, they were of no use, and the government shouldn't buy it, because the government was wanting to buy it through the Pradhan Mantri Fund Yojana and send it to all hospitals in the country. So we had to put our foot down that they will be all thrown in the bin, because they had different kind of holes in it, you know, a lady hole and a man hole, you know, because a man would need a bigger hole to have both the oxygen and all that kind of thing. So it was absurd, and we had to put our foot down on that.
Yeah, the thrust always happens on Delhi for that particular matter. Anyway, I'm so happy to hear that there is not that much of a role for the negative pressure rooms or the special devices. The conventional management goes on. And what other concerns are there in the non-invasive oxygen supplements?
See, the concerns were there. I remember in the among the first of the four patients, and the first one was a Lokpal of a court in with us. So there were huge concerns among the faculty members and the residents and the nurses who were in that areas regarding aerosols. It was a norm that we would not do anything. If a patient is not doing well, he's into respiratory failure, we are going to tube the patient, use a kind of a device and then feel good about it, because there was a perceptible level of threat of death when people were working in these areas, let's be honest. And there were people who refused. As a matter of fact, to be honest, I know medical history of now most of the faculty members in the institute who were posted with us, because they came out with all kind of excuses not to work there. So this aerosol business was a big no for people to work, and we were all very afraid of working. But over the months, when the second surge came, and later on after the first surge, we realized that if you were well clothed, if you were doing well, then all the WhatsApp media which you saw, all the papers which you read, that which kind of a device causes aerosol to go up to what level, as long as you are safe and you are well covered with the right PPEs, the masks and the shields, and you take care of your eyes and everything else, these aerosols are there, they do happen, but you can take care of them.
So the mask and the shield support you, that's going to save you. Now, the question is focusing to Anil Sachdas. Do we have a target oxygenation?
In COVID. Good evening, sir.
In COVID.
So,
target oxygenation in normal,
even,
as well as in COVID situations.
Yeah, even before the COVID came, there was it was a hotly debated topic, with a lot of studies going for lower oxygen and very few saying that lower oxygen had was bad. So we started from the ArtsNet guideline, which recommended a partial pressure of oxygen of 55 to 80 as a target in ARDS patients being ventilated. And then came a lot of studies that questioned that that ArtsNet trial. The major negative study was liberal oxygen versus conservative oxygen, that's 2016. That that study was done in intubated ARDS patients, where they had two groups, which had one had a PO2 of similar to the ArtsNet trial, 55 to 70, and the liberal group was around kept around 90 to 105 milliliters per cubic partial pressure. And the primary outcome was the 28-day mortality, which was which did not show much of difference, but the study was stopped because the secondary outcome, one was 90-day follow-up, which had more number of patients who had mesenteric ischemia. That study was stopped. So that is one negative study against your conservative use of oxygen. But there are a lot of criticism saying that it was underpowered study. It was there was less number of prone patients in the conservative group. And there are many meta-analysis and other studies that came up just before COVID came up in 2021, that's hot ICU randomized control studies, that was for acute hypoxemic respiratory failure patients, which included invasive, non-invasive CPAP and oxygen. The two groups, one at 60 and the other at 90, that is the partial pressure of oxygen. 90-day mortality was, there was no difference. From all these studies, we have some two things that are very clear. Anything more than 96 is not needed at all. So never have a patient with 100% oxygen in your ICU. Second, the lower target is a bit confusing, but anything above 90 is okay. So it's okay. So as per our COVID guidelines, these are the guidelines that have been laid for COVID patients. So it's in WHO, they have 92-94. So they asked to target about 94% in patients who are in distress. And once the patient is stable, you target just about 90. Pregnancy, always you have target a bit higher because of the concern of the fetus also. So around 92-95. ICMR, as previously said, it was between 92-96. So in all the guidelines, one thing is very sure, never go above 96. lower target can be as low as 90 if the patient is relatively stable. So that is thing regarding your COVID oxygenation goals.
As a clinical manager for treating nearly 500 patients every day at a medical college hospital in Trivandrum, you think up to 96 is a permissible level? In that case, what is a normal level? In a normal patient, what should be the oxygenation level? What is your target in a normal ventilation, in a normal patient, or say in everyday theater work?
Normal patients, you mean non-COVID or?
Non-COVID, I mean non-COVID only.
Non-COVID, yeah, this applies to non-COVID patients also. So this can be extrapolated to non-COVID patients also. Maybe yeah. Even your OT, you don't have to go up to 100% oxygen.
No, you mean same thing for the non-COVID also?
Yeah, yes, true.
Do you agree, Gopa Kumar, based on the Odyssey as well as the Gyasaliyorovar equation, this definition or the standard of 92 to 96 is the one acceptable?
What we have to aim is to 94 to 96, sir. That is around 94.
Around 94. Will Anil Kumar, Dr. Divetya, Dr. Anjan, will you agree to this particular statement?
See, what I would like to add here is that this oxygen diffusion curve we have been seeing ever since we were in the third year of medicine. And we all know that beyond a level, this increase in oxygen is not going to help us. But here we've got to see something else. Whatever the number has been mentioned is perfectly fine. But in my experience, what we've seen is that if we try to maintain a saturation about 92, 93, when these patients deteriorate, they don't give us time to really react at times. So ideally speaking, anything above 93 is a very comfortable thing. But if you have, we've had a lot of sudden deaths in patients because of various reasons when we had tried to maintain a saturation of around 90, 91 also, we were comfortable. But then now we've come down to anything above 93, we are very happy at 94. And the other thing was that during this time of the second surge, oxygen was a big issue. We were living from, from a meal to meal. There were times when in Ames, New Delhi, when we had super VIPs in us, we had oxygen reserve of just about 45 minutes till the tanker came. So that was the time when we were very particular about decreasing our oxygen flows and using them and maintaining at a low level. But if you are not having those kind of oxygen issues, anything around 94, one should be comfortable, but not 92. I will not be comfortable at 92 or 91.
So you say anything beyond 94 is not at all needed.
Yeah.
Is that your opinion?
Yes. And we are talking about otherwise normal person.
Yeah,
we are talking about 40-year-old
patient may not be having any comorbidities.
COVID and came to us.
Okay. So I mean, COVID or non-COVID, otherwise if the patient is not having any non-COVID issues or say no other comorbidities, 94 is the maximum to be achieved for a normal result. Do you agree, Jiggy Devetia, for this particular statement?
Yes, so I think 94 is a very comfortable SpO2. And like it was mentioned earlier by Anjan, even it depends on what sort of facilities you have and what sort of expertise are there and that sort of thing. Now, for example, a patient who's in the initial phase of acute hypoxic respiratory failure, who are still getting to start oxygenating well. So there, a 94 is, and he's, let's say he's on oxygen, he's on NIV or he's on high flow nasal with the potential to get intubated, then you want a slight buffer before you can sort of, so that, when you have to intubate, he's not crashing when you want to intubate him. On the other hand, when they are recovering, when you know the recovery is set in, then, you can even accept lower SpO2 of 92 or something like that. So it all depends on the situation and the sort of facilities that you have. And if you're in a well-monitored ICU, we tend to accept lower. In some very, very sick patients, say in the past with H1N1 or now in some with COVID, you try what you want, your saturation doesn't go beyond 85. So a lot of things depend. But as a general rule, I agree that 94 is a comfortable saturation. You should not really push much beyond 94. 94 is good. If your patient is doing well and getting better, when you're thinking of actually weaning the patient or something like that, you can try be happy with the lower PO2 and lower saturation around 92%.
Nice that the efficiency of everybody, including a faculty member and a resident, decreases by anything. It has been proven by 25% to 40% when you are wearing those PPEs and working. So whenever a patient is deteriorating, you need a bigger buffer of oxygen when you are trying to do a procedure. So nothing below 94 in an ICU when a patient is sick.
How about you, Anup? You also agree to this one, Anup Kumar?
I completely agree with Dr. Divatia. I think we will have to individualize and case by case, we will have to decide at what level of oxygenation we will have to keep. I don't feel like every patient we have to keep at 94 or 93. There is nothing like a figure like that, and there is no data to say that also all patients should have a particular value. Rather than that, as Dr. Divatia was mentioning, like depending on the severity of illness, the phase of illness, you can decide. Like especially when you are weaning off from ventilator or weaning off from HFNC, or if the patient is already on like an oxygen therapy where you are planning to discharge the patient on home. So that point of time, I think you can even accept lower values, somewhere around 90, 92 will be okay. So I think there is no point in discussing a particular value, say 90, 92, 93, etc. Rather than that, like a saturation somewhere around 90 or 92 will be acceptable depending on the situation. I think that would be
what I was trying to say, Anup, there is no need to have any heroic attempt to make it above 94, because 94 is absolutely all right. Even in our clinical situations of everyday life, 94 is a good oxygenation status.
I think, sir, we can conclude by saying that the hyperoxygenation is always going to harm the patient. Never try to hyperoxygenate the patient. An optimal level of oxygenation will be acceptable for all patients. It is applicable for COVID patients as well.
What are the problems associated with hyperoxygenation or hyperoxia, and what is being recognized during your COVID treatment? Our overzealous administration is going to produce some problem?
I think sir was asking about the issues with hyperoxygenation.
Yes.
Okay. The first thing is that we all know oxygen is a drug, but if it is given at a higher concentration for a short period of time, nothing happens. But when we talk about hyperoxia, the classical study which has been published is about you using hyperoxia, higher level of oxygen in acute MI patients, and the results were bad as compared to people who were not given any oxygen at all after acute MI when they come to the hospital. And this is a normal thing which we have been doing for so many years, that acute MI, if somebody comes here, put an oxygen mask and try to have a saturation which is much more than what is required. So more important here is, and this has come into play now, is when we are dealing with shortage of oxygen. I think that becomes more important here. There would be place, antioxidants could be a problem at that time. A collapse because of higher levels of oxygen over a larger number of time duration, that comes later on. But in this pandemic and in the second surge, what has become important is that why are we needing a saturation of 100%? Why are we using 6 liters even with a face mask, or let's say 3 liters with a nasal prong, and maintaining a saturation of 98, 99 when we don't require it and we can save oxygen for somebody else? I think that becomes very important in this pandemic now.
I think the pandemic has taught us something which we should have been practicing long ago, is you don't need a saturation of 98 and 99%. A 94 in a stable patient, a 94% just as a ballpark is good enough. You don't need very high oxygen saturations. The problem with hyperoxia, you know, when we say is whether it's we are talking of a high alveolar PO2 or whether you're talking of a high arterial PO2. And, you know, so the high arterial PO2, for example, we know the normal is about 80 to 100. So we don't know what is hyperoxia, whether it's 120, more than 120, or more than 150, or more than 200. And, you know, like we, so there's few problems with this, but I think as a ballpark figure, a 94% saturation seems to be, anything more than that seems to be not really necessary. And I at least the pandemic has helped us focus on that as a potential target. One is, of course, of saving oxygen, but also possibly of avoiding excessive oxygen use, which can be detrimental to the patient.
See, one thing we are, which I would like to point out here is, and through ICA, we are going to the peripheries also. If we are monitoring our saturation with those thumb pulse oximeters, which are portable or whatever you call them, the saturation numbers which come are so varied from place to place, and people tend to panic a lot. I'm aware of certain small setups where they didn't have so many monitors. So most of the patients were on those 1400 rupees pulse oximeters, which you could put on the thumb, and the numbers available both for the pulse rate and the saturations were not really very authentic. So the take home message here is that don't go on that number once you get it. If you get a pulse rate of 148 and then you see that the pulse is not 148, then that number of on the saturation, whatever comes may not be correct. This has to be put across because this has become an everyday affair. Pulse rate of 190, a saturation of 90, and otherwise everything is okay. But if you see a radial pulse, it is good 92 or 94. So one must realize that we have been teaching our resident that unless you see a waveform, you go on a, don't believe that saturation number on the monitor. We've been trying to teach our residents, our nurses, but with these small monitors on your thumb and fingers, you have to see that bar thing in the right way, which is coming regularly, then only you can comment upon a number.
That's a very interesting observation, sir.
Yeah, good.
Sticking on with oxygen expenditure, I think one more device which has become more popular during COVID time is the high flow nasal cannulas. And they were very much debated whether HFNC is consuming more oxygen or NAV is consuming more oxygen. Dr. Anoop, can you elaborate on this point? How to choose which device to use depending on the patient category, and when to choose HFNC and when to declare, no, I'm going ahead with the next level oxygen therapy support to the patient.
I think like almost all smaller units started using this high flow nasal cannula after our like COVID surge. And even all the guidelines, including the initial SCCM guidelines, clearly mentions about the usage of HFNC, and again, HFNC is recommended over NIV in COVID-19 patients. So usually how we go about is, usually we start with the oxygen nasal cannula. If not tolerating, go ahead with the oxygen mask. If not tolerating, go with the NRBM. So even with NRBM, if patient is tachypneic or requirement is going high, we usually start them on high flow nasal cannula. So the previously we were using higher flows as well. So as you all know, we will be having a flow setting and an FiO2 setting. So in the initial days, especially when the patient was more hypoxemic and you need a PEEP effect, we are using flow up to 60 liters. And again, FiO2 titrate. And then obviously you will have to see whether the patient is tolerating HFNC. So usually we go ahead with the so-called ROX index. You can assess the ROX index after initiating HFNC at particular time, like 1 hour, like 6 hours, like that. And you try to see what is the ROX index. And if the ROX index is more than 5, that means the patient is tolerating the HFNC. The issue with the HFNC was like when the case numbers have increased, then when there was a shortage of oxygen, definitely this HFNC is having a higher oxygen consumption compared to NIV or our invasive ventilator, because here we are using a continuous flow. When you are going with an NIV or when you are using a like invasive ventilator, the oxygen delivery is during the inspiratory phase of ventilation alone. But here you have a continuous supply of oxygen required. And another issue is, especially when you keep a very high flow, as the flow rates more than say 60 liters, then obviously when you need a higher FiO2, you may have to use higher oxygen flows, somewhere around 30 to 35 liters per minute, to maintain FiO2 of somewhere around 60, 70, etc. So you should have a clear-cut idea how to use HFNC to assess whether the patient is really tolerating or not. And again, there is no point in keeping on very, very high FiO2 on HFNC. Like I've seen the people using 100% oxygen on HFNC and thinking that the patient is stable. So please don't do like that. If as I've already mentioned, if the ROX index is not maintained or if the patient is having any other issues, then obviously we will have to go ahead with invasive ventilation or a short trial of NIV as well, especially when the patient is having like a very high tidal volume, etc. Sometimes like a PEEP effect with a non-invasive for a short time or like intermittently using NIV and HFNC may help. But obviously in a pandemic situation, you may not have enough devices to switch over between NIV and HFNC. But as Dr. Sanish was mentioning, your oxygen requirement is always a problem when you are using HFNC. That also the flow rates more than 40 liters per minute. And again, you should not keep on like increasing the FiO2 in HFNC or NIV. And I feel that like any other illnesses or ARDS or pneumonia, here in COVID also, you will have to ventilate the patient at an appropriate point of time. There is no point in unnecessarily delaying the intubation, thinking that if you intubate or like if you are going for an invasive ventilation, you are going to lose the patient. There is nothing like that. In my personal experience, I feel that an appropriate at an appropriate time, you will have to intervene and go for invasive ventilation. And I think that will be the best way to save the patient and to avoid more and more self-inflicted lung injury.
Dr. Anjan, would you like to add on to this?
Most of the things what have been mentioned are now standard practice. I must put across here that sometimes in the month of May, June, July last year, it was a wonder modality which came, and it came in a big way. The high flow nasal cannulas, they were in short supply all over our country, and everybody thought that they've had a wonder. If you could have some, you could do wonders with the patients. What we luckily, or whatever you can call about sitting in Delhi, we had enough of them, but we soon realized that our pressure alarms in our manifold room started blowing off because the ICUs and the flow rates from the manifold were never meant to be having, let's say, in a 80 or 100 bedded ICU, at least 60 HFNCs working at 30 liters or 40 liters per minute. So that is a concern one must think about it, that the ICUs which were made before COVID era had some standard guidelines which came from the developed countries, where in a 10 bedded ICU, let's say, there would be 5 patients on a ventilator, 2 on oxygen and something of that kind. There is a formula which we had with us. So high flow nasal cannulas came into vogue, and then they gradually went out because we started getting at Delhi itself, we started getting a lot of patients who developed barotrauma, which varied from pneumothorax, unilateral, bilateral, and pneumomediastinum also. And a lot of patients started coming in from peripheral hospitals with pneumomediastinums and barotrauma because high flow nasal cannulas were used. Let's be honest that a high flow nasal cannula is very comfortable for a patient. All our patients who would be with us and who are compliant, and we've seen this, that the patient is complying to what we say, our outcomes are better. Lying prone, and we do a lot of conscious proning, is much more easier than NIV mask, the photograph which you've shown it. Other issue is that to have a right fitted NIV mask in an older age group patient where the chin is receding or something of that kind, it's a problem. And we acquired a lot of helmets to give NIV, but the patients, we just didn't use them. There are about 25 lying with us, we didn't use it. So our protocol is also the same, like it has already been mentioned, start from nasal oxygen, go off to non-rebreathing face mask. If it goes beyond 12 to 15 liters, we know it's not working. And then you decide that you've got to go on a high flow nasal cannula or a NIV. Normally, if the CO2 is much high, NIVs will work better. But we've also now boiled down to the basic fact that if it's better to have intermittent, let's say, 4-hourly schedules or 5-hourly schedules of HFNCs and NIV. The basic rule is that you could get a PEEP of about 5 if the patient is willing to keep his mouth closed and have an HFNC. But the flow rates have to be mentioned, have to be very carefully monitored. Now it's a dictum there in our ICU, and we've seen to it, and I insist upon this, that we will not go to 60 liters, the max which is available, because the number of cases with barotrauma is increasing. So we limit ourselves to 0.6, 0.7, 0.8 FiO2. If you can manage with 40 to 50 liters, it's okay. Otherwise, you try to move into NIVs. The other thing is that it's in the first surge, we were delaying intubations because as per the literature available, if you intubate a patient, the patient goes to a different level and you will have a X amount of mortality. And we were afraid about that. This time, we are slightly more comfortable intubating patients earlier because now we have much more trained staff. You can well imagine that if I had a 20-bedded ICU and suddenly in the last first surge, I had a 100-bedded ICU, where did the nurses come in? Where was the healthcare manpower? So we were delaying intubation first time. This time we are liberal with our intubations, but then one has to see to it that in a public hospital, whether you can cater to so many people who are intubated and prone. At times at our place, we would have about 50 to 60 patients who are prone, but you will have to have a team who can manage a prone patient. So we decided to have proning teams. There were at least one chap was there in a team of three doctors who knew what pruning was all about because it's a pandemic situation. So these small little things we had to do, but the flow chart, what has been mentioned, is perfectly fine. But one must keep into mind what kind of manpower you have, what kind of an ICU you have, and what number of patients you are treating. See, managing 50 prone patients on four different floors of ICU is tough. And that is when we have monitors. You know, you are so very afraid of proning a patient, giving him a relaxant, and there could be a disconnection because we got a lot of ventilators which were new to the residents who were working with them. It's always nice to work on a ventilator and a monitor with which you are familiar. If you get a ventilator which is new, you get a Hamilton, you never use a Hamilton, and then you want to prone a patient, you are a bit apprehensive. So these are small little things which we'll have to keep in mind when we manage these patients in a COVID kind of a pandemic.
That's an interesting observation. Actually, I was curious to know how many institutions across the country can afford to manage patients on prone ventilation. Dr. Anil, what's your experience with this? The switching over from NIV HFNC failure to invasive ventilation?
Yeah, we have a level 3 ICU. So most of patients that come into our ICU have a lot of distress. So we usually start with NIV and then we gradually wean them to HFNC if it is possible. But if it's other way around, we monitor their workup breathing. So in any mode of oxygen therapy, you should be monitoring the workup breathing, how much they put in to breathe, especially when they use the accessory muscles and they have a lot of effort they put in. So that is one that we monitor very closely. And then patients not recovering in 1 to 2 hours, we plan for intubation. And in all the steps, we always consider awake proning. So we can consider, and that might not work when the patient is having a lot of distress with NIV or HFNC. So proning is considered in every point of time. Also after intubation, we do prone patients.
About awake proning, we realized that in an Indian male, because of truncal obesity, awake proning is a problem. Majority of the people above 50 years of age will have some kind of truncal obesity. And the same is true with women. So awake proning in that age group is a problem, in spite of the fact that you have special pillows below the chest and below the hips. So what we decided that, well, fine, you can't make them prone. If they are not if they are uncomfortable, let them lie right up and left up most of the times. That was the second option available to us. And yes, as per the literature, awake proning is the results. What you get by awake proning, the improve in oxygen, is not persistent. But here what is important is that, fine, it is not persistent if you see all the literature available. But if a patient is willing to do that, lie prone for about 14 to 16 hours in an ICU out of 24 hours, and that excludes the meal times, then it gives you enough time for the rest of the medications to take up than a patient who is not lying prone. This is what we've learned here. We try to convince him that this is one thing which he can do lying there doing nothing. So if he does it, his saturation improves in large number of patients. And if he turns supine, it again goes back to the same. But if he's prone, then we get some time, let's say for 4 days, 5 days, and we can avoid a lot of intubations. We have done that just because of awake proning.
So Dr. Sanish, if I may just come in here.
Yes, please, sir.
You know, in acute hypoxic respiratory failure, in a non-pandemic situation, HFNC is probably superior to non-invasive ventilation. Okay, so that is our initial approach. Once you say there's a pandemic situation, shortage of staff, shortage of beds, shortage of oxygen, then it's a different ballgame. You have to adapt to the situation. Now, non-invasive ventilation is given by two types of devices. One is by the simple BiPAP devices. So, you know, the small portable BiPAP devices, which were usually in the past used mainly for COPD, respiratory failure. Now, the problem with them is that they can only take FiO2, which is bled in from a flow meter of about 10 to 15 liters, and the FiO2 it can achieve is only about 50% plus minus a little bit. So if you need non-invasive ventilation and higher FiO2, you have to go to ICU ventilator with non-invasive ventilation. And there, you know, they can have lots of leak compensation. So the flow rates can actually be 100, 120 liters. And then you might actually have a slightly higher oxygen consumption than with a BiPAP device. So when you're talking of oxygen consumption with NIV, you have to also see what device you're giving NIV with. With a BiPAP machine, certainly your oxygen consumption, if your patient needs only about 50-odd% oxygen, your oxygen consumption is quite low and it's quite good. Okay. Now, as far as awake proning is fantastic, and like Dr. Anjan mentioned, if the patient, it should be as prone as possible. So very often, you know, patients have osteoarthritis and they've got knee problems and hip problems and they're fat. So as prone as possible, if it means lateral, lateral, if it means semi-prone, semi-prone. Of course, prone is ideal, but as much as they can prone themselves for as long as possible, I think that is the way to go. And in even for proning, HFNC is much better and more comfortable and technically easier for the staff and for the patient than NIV mask. So that's the other issue with this thing.
But most of the times, people always complain HFNC is putting them to difficulties, whereas NIV they may like. NIV is they are comfortable with to go ahead.
So again, it depends. If your work of breathing is very high, they may benefit from NIV. But if they've got a very high respiratory drive and their work of breathing is high, even say 5 or 8 centimeters pressure support on NIV can generate a huge tidal volume and a very high transmural pressure, which can actually damage the lung after a period of time. So with NIV, that has been a concern of non-invasive ventilation, any hypoxic respiratory failure, including COVID. So if you are generating, you know, those some of those patients are fairly compliant lungs initially and they can generate high tidal volumes, and that can actually damage the lung a little bit more. So you have to be careful when you're talking of NIV or HFNC, and you know, always you have to decide which is the best time to intubate. And I agree that, you know, some patients are dying because you are keeping them without intubation for too long. And so when you say the mortality of intubation is high, it may be that again in a pandemic, people who are not experienced with intubation, the nursing staff and the residents don't know how to handle intubated patients. They may not know how to intubate patients. Some patients are coming late. Some patients, when they come late to the, they come early to the ICU, but we are late, delaying intubation, unnecessarily delaying intubation. Some patients. So there are lots of factors when you talk about mortality, about intubating patients or mortality of intubated patients in COVID. You know, because in these small nursing homes, which have these jumbo centers, which have a so-called ICU, or in small nursing homes, which have become COVID centers, you cannot expect very good outcomes from in intubated patients. But maybe in ICUs like Dr. Trikha's or yours or something, I suspect the mortality, or Dr. Anup Kumar's, like he was mentioning, the mortality in intubated patients may not be desperately high. So again, in the pandemic, you know, everything depends on how your resources are and what sort of expertise and facilities you have. So, I mean, it's a different ballgame when you're talking of a surge, and it's a different thing when you're talking of a few patients in the ICU who are ventilated.
So in short, it's difficult to decide whether HFNC or NIV stands better in circumstances. Well, you have to decide depending on the particular complaints of the patient with that particular system. And do you always recommend that if HFNC is failing, we'll go to NIC, then only we'll go to invasive ventilation? Or if one failing, why can't we go to the invasive ventilation straight?
Can I?
Do we have to try out both?
Can I make a remark here?
Please.
Okay. See, one thing is very sure that HFNC has not been validated in COVID-19 till date by any study which is worthwhile. Okay, it has been validated in before pre-pandemic area times. So what normally is done, it is not a ritual that you first go to HFNC, if it fails, go to NIV and then you intubate a patient. One has to use his or her clinical expertise to see, well, this patient is not going to benefit from any non-invasive device. We must intubate this patient. And it's the same thing everywhere. If you see within 2 hours, your NIV has failed, your HFNC has failed, the patient has become, the GCS has gone low, he's a poor M6 or he's going into M5, that is the time you must intubate. I totally agree with Dr. Divetia. No patient should die because we don't intubate. It's worthwhile to lose a patient after intubation because you've tried everything else. Then if you are having a reasonable expertise, you must intubate a patient and maybe then refer a patient to a higher center. You have gained a couple of hours. You've gained about 12 hours of drive to a different hospital and then let the patient, whatever may happen to the patient, you don't feel sorry about it.
Thank you. In fact, that was the answer we were looking for. That means don't play with the patient that much. Even don't go with the invasive ventilation and try to save the patient.
And try to gain some time and expertise help.
Yeah. Okay. That's correct. And regarding the prone ventilation, are the people accepting prone ventilation? Probably the COVID patient may be accepting. If you are telling the COVID patients, well, this is the only way you could be saved. But otherwise also, what I am wondering is that even if the true prone is not possible, why can't the patient put on semi-prone? That also is going to help. True lateral or semi-prone, will that help to some extent?
See, that's what I had said, that there is no study which has shown us that the benefits obtained by conscious proning will last for a couple of hours or 10 hours or 12 hours or 3 days or 4 days. But yes, you are very right. There will be a lot of patients. And Dr. Divetia has said, and I think I didn't add to that, and that thing with truncal obesity, osteoarthritis knee, osteoarthritis hip, they are all there in our patients. So if not prone, a semi-prone or a lateral, but if you are trying to intubate them and patient is getting hypoxic, then to have 4 to 8 sessions of at least in the first go for 14 hours of pruning is a standard care now it is for COVID-induced ARDS.
Yeah, good. Now, what do we suggest? How oxygen therapy should be guided during transportation of a patient from a point to another point?
See,
the transportation of patient and oxygen therapy connected.
Okay, we have made a protocol because earlier on in the disease, if you've come to Delhi, you've seen our AIIMS hospital, our COVID center is just, we have an underground dedicated tunnel from our main building to this COVID building. We lost a couple of patients during transport because we realized even in a hospital, intra-hospital transport took about 1.5 hours with all the PPEs and everything, cylinders. So now the dictum is if a patient requires more than 5 to 6 liters of oxygen, then be very careful, a doctor to accompany a patient. But if a patient is requiring, let's say 12 to 15 liters of oxygen, we are not going to shift him. It's worthwhile to tube this patient, get a transport ventilator, a monitor, a doctor on board and not a OTDA and then shift the patient. Now this has become a norm, not only inside our hospital, from anywhere else around our hospital. There could be a corporate hospital doing well on 12 liters. Sorry, we don't want to give him air. Wait for some time, either he or she improves, or if she deteriorates, tube the patient and get him in.
Do anybody check on the availability of the oxygen in the cylinder when a patient is transported? Or what check-in mechanism would be brought there?
See, what we have done is we've outsourced our shifting ambulances and the staff. The first few months, we had our own staff, our own ambulances, and we were having problems. Now we've outsourced it. Somebody is getting paid for it. So he sees to it depending upon the time duration. See, we have received patients who have come to us from Himachal Pradesh or Bihar for about 14 hours of driving time, 14 to 16 hours. So the thumb rule is that you calculate the amount of time your oxygen cylinder is going to last, multiply it by at least 2. If oxygen is not available, at least with 1.5, and then get that kind of oxygen in your ambulance and then shift. The same is true intra-city shifting. Shift them late in the night when the traffic is less, or if there is lockdown, it is perfectly fine. but you should have enough of oxygen for 1.5 times the driving time.
What is your opinion, Arvind, on this particular matter? Because you are talking on the cylinders and the cylinder transportation and all that. What is your opinion in this particular matter?
This is a matter of concern, as Dr. Anjan has pointed out. Mainly to factor the fact that many patients have been being transported with just face mask. Many are going tubed. In all situations, the requirement of oxygen is going to be factored in based on the flow liters per minute. And then let's not forget that this is read out from the dials of the pressure gauges of oxygen sources, oxygen cylinders. And then we need to have a reserve capacity in case there's a delay, traffic problems and patient-related issues, patient having some sudden problems, we have to stop over and so on. And unfortunately, unlike if I run out of cash in the 14-hour drive, I can go to an ATM and withdraw some cash. We don't have oxygen ATMs, unfortunately. Maybe the pandemic will get that into focus, just like we have petrol pumps for fueling our car. But as of now, it's a fantasy and we cannot really look for alternative sources. Or maybe the only option is to look for or have a plan when the drive time is more than 2 hours to have a designated town or a city in between where you can pick up cylinders. Coming to that aspect, it's having considered that different types of categories of cylinders are available, different types of instruments are needed to handle, to change the regulators and to ensure the flow of gas. It's a gargantuan task for us to even think of shifting. And unfortunately, most of our friends all across the country have had to contend with this on a regular basis. Though theoretically, we look at it and we can give number of solutions on paper. But when it comes to actual conduct and safety of a patient while transport, hypoxia has been seen in most situations because of the varying logistical issues, the different manufacturers having different types of cylinders, different equipments needed, and so on, and the fittings. Even inside a hospital, in different floors, we have had issues with transporting cylinders. And as Dr. Anjan pointed out, intra-hospital transport has also thrown this into focus, wherein many a times the staff members don't get to read the actual pressures and then we end up with low oxygen. And then everybody panics, and then with the PPE suited up and the patient in also being in different kinds of wraps, it's very difficult to go. So I cannot offer a common solution. But yes, the idea is to look into the pressures, have an idea of the flow rate, and then factor a margin, safety margin of 1.5 to 2 times that which is needed. I hope I have shown some light on that.
Yeah, thank you.
So just any one...
Will everybody agree to this suggestion of Aravind's? Is there any difference of opinion?
No. So no difference of opinion, just an additional consideration. You also need to see what kind of transport ventilator you have. You know, some of the older ones, they are sort of minute volume dividers. So they are powered by oxygen. So they guzzle oxygen. Those should be completely avoided. You need one, those are battery powered, where you only bleed in oxygen from a flow meter to increase the FiO2. If you use an oxygen-powered ventilator, you're going to lose a lot of oxygen. So you should completely avoid those and make sure you're using the other type of transport ventilator.
An additional comment here, which we saw during this oxygen shortage, when you send cylinders to be filled up and they were in the ambulances and in your stores, the people who were filling up were not filling it up to the right amount. So one needed to check it very authentically what was being given. You know, it is normally seen that if you are in a situation where you have to, we have had instance in Delhi where not one but many where the trucks bringing in liquid oxygen were hijacked. So they were all brought to various hospitals and their police escorts, which was official. So even the cylinders which came to us were half filled. They never lasted that many number of hours. So that has to be kept in mind in a time when there is oxygen security. So now we have all these as SOPs, which we have given to the government. Government will come out with it very soon, provided we get the third surge, which I think we will not. But these things are important.
These sort of things can happen anywhere. Is any SOP being written now on all these particular matters? SOP being written?
The government is working on it. I'm aware of a group which is working for primarily for the third surge. They already have a number of, let's say, if you have a 10-bedded ICU, how much of oxygen, blah, 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 everything. What is the healthcare worker? Ideally, and in a pandemic, nurse ratio, all that stuff is being managed and one would come out with the Ministry of Health coming out with the with a document, especially before the third surge, because there was this a huge scare which is there in the press that the third surge would involve a lot of pediatric patients. This was following a report which was published, which talked about zero positivity of 3,000 children in Karnataka, I think, or somewhere that side. It was, the number was 3,000, it was zero positivity and not people who were infected and were having symptoms. So, but anyway, the government is gearing up with this next fear, which we hope is that a large number of children will come as patients and we'll have to deal with them.
Yeah, when is the third surge expected? And why you think the pediatrics or the lower age group patients are going to be affected more?
See, there are a lot of, we are very clear on that. There are two things we are very clear of. Women do better, not perimenopausal women, but younger age group women do better with COVID, and children have less number of symptoms. There are various theories on that. And one of the theories is that they have less amount of ACH receptors. So there are various reasons that children do better than older people, and children land up with super spreaders to their grandparents and parents, and that's why they are carriers. So, but as a rule, children have done better than older adult people as compared to older people, and women have generally done better. There are at least two studies which are going on in US where they are injecting older men with oxytocin to see whether the female hormones are protective for this COVID virus.
So I think
female hormone, that's a different consideration. What I'm asking is, what is special about children?
So, you know, so in children, yes, I think what is happening is, they are seeing a lot of children that are affected now, and they think this virus is affecting children more. But I'm not so sure that that is the case. Simply that, let's say 10% of patients in the first surge were children. So let's say if there were 1,000 patients, you would get 100 children. Now you're seeing 5,000 children, but the number of patients that are there are also 10 times as much. So
which means
the proportion is the same, but the absolute number is very high. That's because we are only looking at the numerator, we are not looking at the denominator. And if you look at both, maybe the rate of infection is probably the same, maybe plus minus a little here and there. So while we've seen a large number of children being affected, we've also seen a large number of overall patients. So hopefully all this fear about children may not be
turned out
to be true. And I think I heard AIIMS director in one of his interviews, multiple TV interviews, saying that maybe it's not going to happen, that children will be affected more if there are a third wave. As of now, I think it's the same proportion, but the number, absolute number is high just because we've seen 10 times the number of cases in this wave as in the first wave.
Yes, we at the Institute think this as a group, but then the jury is still out, because we'll only come to know it when you open the schools and Maruti vans full of children will go to school with bags over them or whatever, and they will share their food and play in playing grounds. All that will be there when the schools open up.
Yeah, but that all this data is when schools are closed. So we don't know what's going to happen when schools open. In Mumbai, all the data was when the trains were not working. When the trains start, we don't know what's going to happen.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes. Sir, we are coming to the conclusion of our panel discussion. I think just when we were discussing about the possible third wave, we need to think something about post-COVID syndromes. So are we going in for more people going in for a long-term oxygen with oxygen concentrators or home oxygen therapy?
Yes, we have a meeting every day at 8 o'clock in the morning. We were thinking today and deliberating whether we should have a post-COVID discharge patients ward, and then we realized that we can't have it because the number of beds we could attribute will be too less. There are so many patients coming, especially after the second surge with this new Delta strain. We see a lot of patients who start having fever at day 25, day 26, their markers go haywire, their oxygen requirements go up, and they finally come back to us again. So initially we tried to manage them at their own houses, and these oxygen concentrators were being sold in black like everything else in India. So the max is that you can give about 10 liters of oxygen from two different flow meters. The good ones, most of them are made in China, but the best ones will have two flow meters to give a max of about 5 liters of oxygen. That to about 93%, and you know that it will not be very well humidified. We are using a lot of these. As a matter of fact, we have been using oxygen concentrators in our ward during this oxygen crisis. We have about 500 of them in our own hospital so that we could prevent the central manifold oxygen from being used. So oxygen concentrators, like in North India, we have every household who can afford has an air purifier at home. So now oxygen concentrator is the next thing. You could gift it to all your friends if you have it, because everybody has it and they would be used anyway. But I'm sure in the long, like the long COVID patients, that is what the term is, long COVID, we'll have to use domiciliary oxygen in a large number of patients and monitor them.
Yeah, I agree. I think we've sent many more patients this time on home oxygen than we did in the first wave. Again, whether it's numerator, denominator, I don't know, but we've seen a lot of patients dependent on oxygen when they are going home.
See, what I have realized and we've realized at our end is that in the second surge, there was a lot of mismanagement by our colleagues in smaller areas. They were not only the smaller areas, best possible known doctors have had steroids earlier on in the disease. And then they have landed up with complications, and then they land up with us. So there has been a mismanagement. Steroids are an over-the-counter drug in India, as like everything else. So that's why patients are coming to us more sicker. And that's why what Dr. Divetia had said, we have sent a large number of patients, not only home on oxygen, but with the tracheostomy tube in situ to come back later to us and we'll decandidate them.
Good. Well, we like to wind up in another 2-3 minutes time. After discussing it for the last 60-70 minutes, do any of you discussant would like to say any special measure to prevent COVID infecting us? Any special measures than the standard measures which have been notified, that use a mask, well, good sanitation, keep a distance. Apart from this, anything else?
Vaccinated.
Only thing is what
vaccine,
he said.
That's again preventive.
Vaccinated.
At the earliest possible, get vaccinated.
Get vaccinated.
The problem is the government, and we form part of Delhi. Government has been changing the number of weeks for the second shot, and everybody is confused what is to be done. For it was 4 weeks, then 6 weeks, then 12 weeks, and now it is the latest is if your child is going abroad, he can get it after 4 weeks. Now everybody's child is going abroad now. So they all want it after 4 weeks. But as long as you can get vaccinated, we were trying to bring in, and I think Dr. Devitya will feel it interesting. We were trying to insist that can we tell people in our campus that you will only be allowed to give your MD exam or a DM exam if you show us that you have been vaccinated.
At least in certain parts of the country.
I'll tell you what. If you are traveling by Go Air from Delhi, they are doing a RAT there. If you are positive, they send you back. However, it is a medical legal issue because still, as per Government of India, vaccination is not essential. But we surely think now that if not people who are going out, if people they are coming in, the fresh batch, they will have to give us a certificate whether they are vaccinated or not. So at least we can talk to them, why aren't they vaccinated?
I think this will indirectly come in. Maybe once a vaccination is freely available, even insurance companies will not insure if you're not vaccinated. You know, if someone gets COVID and you're not vaccinated, they will not give you your insurance money. So some sort of indirect pressure is going to happen, whether it's for exam, whether it's for travel, or whether it's for reimbursement.
I must share here with you that because COVID vaccination was only allowed above 60 years of age or whatever, earlier on, there were a lot of people who were trying to fiddle around with that. And then it was brought out in the media that the insurance companies are keeping a track of how many comorbidities you are giving at the vaccination center so that you may be allowed. So your insurance claims will go up because you've got the vaccination, because you said you're asthmatic, hypertensive and coronary artery disease, you need it. But then next year, when you go for your medical insurance, your premium is going to go up because you have said that. So these kind of things are there, rightly said, because vaccination shots are less. But once it is there, it will become essential and legal.
Commercial groups always will take advantage. We cannot escape from that. Anyway, it's good because all over the world, the same thing is happening. And we are all progressing towards it because we are not knowing. Through SARS-1, we learn certain things. Through the SARS-2, we are stabilizing on certain other facts. And if the SARS-3 comes, well, we may come to know more things. And we will get educated and we will start taking precautions. Well, we discussed on certain areas whether any of the panelists would like to add anything more than what we discussed.
If I may be allowed to, there is a growing apprehension among some of the colleagues who have already got the vaccination in the first wave, December, January, February. I know officially started from January 15th. So now we are in June. So a few months down the line, it's going to be 6 to 7 months past when the first vaccination cycle has completed. And given the vaccine shortages in India and abroad, so a booster or the safety of going without one, or are we going to accept the fact that like tuberculosis and malaria, endemicity is going to help us? Not just, it's just pandemicity now. So are we going to be protected just because of the fact that we are working among so many other people who are infected? So these apprehensions need to be addressed. Anything on that, sir?
I don't think there's any data to go by it, but just from logic, I guess we'll all need a booster at some stage. And whether we get Pfizer or Moderna or just another AstraZeneca or whatever, but I think for the next few years, we are going to live with COVID till we really figure out what this is happening. You know, for all that we are talking really little about this virus.
Yeah, I thought it may go on like the dengue.
No, it will go on. We'll live with it and we'll all buy it.
My fear is that it may go on like the dengue or the chikungunya. It may carry on. It's some sort of another viral fever or viral pneumonia continuing. Well, we will be masters how to tackle it over the period of time. Thanks once again, all dear panelists. Today, through our discussion, we were able to say that at SARS-1, well, we are frantically looking for negative places and all the new fancy appliances like a helmet or the box, which are not being advised now. Nobody looks for, nobody runs for. And again, well, target vaccination required is around 95%, and we don't need usually beyond 95%, even in COVID times. If we can get up to 95%, that is excellent. And try to achieve that. And with HFNC and NIV, well, HFNC, as Anjan telling, its study is not getting validated, or nobody has any clear-cut idea on the HFNC usage. But anyway, wastage is going to be more with HFNC, but vaccine has to be administered more in quantity. When vaccine is administered more in quantity, wastage will be there. We can't help it. But anyway, at the earliest, when HFNC failing, or say NIV failing, look for invasive ventilation. Probably that is the one thing which we have to take. Regarding the prone, semi-prone, well, as far possible, encourage. People should be told the benefits and try to make them accept and make them compliant to the situations of prone or semi-prone ventilation. As many ways as possible. And regarding the transport of patients, well, at least make sure that you have adequate amount of oxygen, at least 2 times the journey time of oxygen should be available with you when you are venturing to transport a patient, whether it is going to be a contracted service or your own service. And we hope third surge will not affect us by the time everything will settle. Anyway, that's my hope. Thank you all once again. Thank you, Devetia, Anjan.
Thank you very much, sir.
Anil Satyadas.
Yes, sir.
Gopakumar, Arvind, for being with us and highlighting this particular area to make us know what we should do in future when we are confronted with a problem.
Thank you very much.
Can I invite Dr. Jayashree for a vote of thanks?
Good evening, everybody. We are spellbound. There's no other word I can say today. We are absolutely spellbound by the webinar, the lectures, and the panel discussion, and no words to express our appreciation. There were so many queries and so many questions which have been answered by the speakers, and I could see that they are answering. Dr. Devetia was just answering right now. So, but if there are any other questions, of course, you can always mail to them later on. And Dr. Trikha brought out such points of Delhi being, I being from Delhi also. So we've really experienced such a lot of it. And truly speaking, the panel discussion and the lectures was so essential. No webinar on oxygen could be complete without the basics. And Dr. Arvind and Dr. Gopak Kumar, your lectures were so good. The students will benefit so much. And with the panel discussion, as we all are hoping that the third surge or the third wave should not be there, but we are all preparing for it. And yes, the government of India has got these various committees in which, in fact, our chairman of our hospital is also looking after giving suggestions for the oxygen that is requirement is there. So I must say that we were very, very happy. And today, I would also like to compliment Dr. Radhakrishnan for the wonderful moderation, and Dr. Sanish, who's always there, and he's such an important part of our webinars. And it's so nice that we are completing this first year with such a lovely and interactive webinar. And thank you very much. And we look forward to such panel discussions and lectures in the future. And we're hoping to see you all and meet you all on the 17th of July for our annual celebrations. Thank you very much. Good night, everybody.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Good night.
Thank you so much. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, sirs. Thank you.
Good night.